Good afternoon, everybody. Let's do this again. Happy Constitution Day. It's great to be with all of you, and this really is an auspicious occasion for us to kick off this year's Madison Vision Series. Now, as the Vision Series enters its third year and our country gears up for a presidential election, have you noticed that in 2016? But we're already well on our way there. I do want to point out an exciting trend regarding our speakers in this series. Two of our past Madison Vision Series speakers are now running for President of the United States. In April 2014, Carly Fiorina, a former board member here, served as our final speaker in the inaugural year of the series. And of course, as you know, she is seeking the Republican nomination. You probably saw her on television last night. But to keep things balanced, our 2015 final speaker was Professor Lawrence Lessig, who is now seeking the Democratic nomination. So while I believe this lecture series would gain momentum and attract important minds to our campus over time, I can honestly say I certainly did not foresee this particular pattern. So Professor Harris, feel free to make your announcement today. This would be a great occasion, I think, for that on Constitution Day. Speaking of the Constitution, after all these years, of course, the Constitution, as you know, still serves as the legal foundation for our country. It's still debated and dissected, even today. As an institution that's named for the father of the Constitution and one that strives to emphasize not just rights of citizens in a democratic society, but also their responsibilities, it's crucial that we at JMU continue to focus our attention on the Constitution. As James Madison University, we must not lose sight of the principles set forth by the Founding Fathers, while also seeking to understand and appreciate the incredible adaptability of the document that continues to serve as the law of the land. On this Constitution Day, you may have seen our students out on the commons distributing pocket copies of the Constitution, as well as cake, which was very good, by the way. And I did get my copy. If you haven't, you should get one of these at some point. Have it around and actually read it. So this is a great resource for you, as we'll talk about today. Now, the fun continues this week. We want you to know that on Saturday, we're going to send a contingent from JMU to Montpelier, which of course is the historic home of James and Dolly Madison and our partner on many different endeavors as they host their Constitution Day celebration. And you can get more information about that. You can look on the website or ask one of us. We'd be happy to share information about that trip on Saturday. Now, some of you in the audience may also have participated in the debate over the newly established voter precinct here, which will open for elections next year. So that's something we're very proud that our students took a leadership role in making that happen. And along those lines, next week, our students and student organizations, specifically Duke's Vote, will be facilitating a voter registration competition on campus among several different organizations, starting on September 22nd, which is National Voter Registration Day, and running through September 25th. These groups will see who can register the most voters that week while using the convenient TurboVote platform to register voters and provide them with reminders of upcoming elections. So be on the lookout for that. Now, these are just a few of the efforts, of course, on our campus community that will begin to help make us the national model of the engaged university, engaged with ideas, and the world. And that brings me to today's speaker, and who knows, perhaps the next person to announce a run for president. On this 228th anniversary of the signing of the Constitution, we are joined by Professor Stuart Harris, who teaches constitutional law at the Appalachian School of Law here in Virginia. Professor Harris also hosts a nationally syndicated show on National Public Radio, which is appropriately called Your Weekly Constitutional. He also has a sense of humor, as you will see. Mr. Harris served as an attorney for nearly 30 years, which makes two of us, and he practiced in the federal government and worked in a large law firm before establishing his own private practice. He now works in higher education to teach future generations of lawyers while passing along his passion for the Constitution, which I know is a passion that many of us share, and that's why we're here today. The show, Your Weekly Constitutional, focuses on interesting and controversial issues in constitutional law. It continues to feature interviews with knowledgeable lawyers, scholars, and other experts about current and historical topics. It also includes, and this is very important for today, a fun quiz segment. Yes, students, sometimes quizzes can be fun. We're going to get to that experience a bit later. In fact, today we will all get to take part in his radio show, since we'll be recording this presentation to be used as a future episode of Your Weekly Constitutional. So, it's with great pleasure that I welcome to the stage Professor Stuart Harris, who will deliver his lecture on Madisonian ethics. Professor Harris.
Well, golly, thank you. So, Madisonian ethics. Okay, there was this guy. His name was Madison, James Madison, and he was kind of ethical. Did you want more than? Oh, okay, yeah, we'll do that. You'll notice that I said kinda. President Alger said something today at lunch that I think we all need to remember. We were talking specifically about Madison, but we then generalized it to all of the people we sometimes call our founders or sometimes our founding fathers or the framers of the Constitution. And what President Alger said was, we need to respect them, but we should avoid revering them. And that's kind of hard to do. Respect them, but not revere them. They're not gods. They're not demigods. We tend to think of them that way, especially when we've got marble busts of them in our offices. In fact, President Alger has a marble bust. So there's a little hypocrisy going on here. And I've told him the next time I'm in his office, I'm going to go over there, I'm going to chip that bust in a couple of places. James Madison was a living, breathing human being, just like you, just like me. Now, I don't have a university named after me. I suspect most of you don't either. So, okay, he's an extraordinary guy, a remarkable guy. He did some really, really cool things. So we need to respect him. But he wasn't perfect. None of the founders was perfect. So let's always remember that whenever we're talking about the founding era. And that's very important when we interpret the Constitution, especially because we tend to look back to that founding era and the people who actually were in Philadelphia in that summer in 1787, or who were part of the ratification process, or maybe who were part of the drafting of the Bill of Rights, and we tend to look back at them. There's even a school of thought, we call it originalism, in interpreting the Constitution, and we tend to deify them. And we tend to do a lot of other things, like thinking they were monolithic. Well, the founders thought this, really? There were 55 people at the convention. There were 39 signatures on the Constitution. 38 people actually signed, because one guy signed for his bud who wasn't there. That's true. That's really true. With permission. I mean, it wasn't a forgery. I know somebody's going to ask me who that was, and I don't remember, so okay, I'm sorry. 39 people who have their names on that. If you had 39 friends over and you asked them, what kind of pizza to order? Would you get a consensus? Yeah, I didn't think so. And by the way, pineapple on pizza, no. It doesn't happen. Okay, so what we think of these people and how we respect them, or sometimes inappropriately revere them, has great significance in constitutional law. So my subject today is Madison in particular, of all these framers, probably the single most important of them. And his ethics. Ethics are important. Ethics are very much a part of the mission statement of this school, which, by the way, I'm extremely impressed by, and the 8 ethical questions that we're all supposed to ask ourselves before we take any significant action. Ethics are extremely important. And in this, as in everything else, Madison was extraordinary, but not perfect. Not perfect by any means. Today, in the time that I have, before we sit down and get to the fun part, I'm going to discuss 2 issues where Madison did a really good job ethically, in one instance, and in another one, not so much. Not so much. In fact, let's start with the bad one first, shall we? In fact, you know where I'm going with this, don't you? Whenever you talk about Madison or any of the founders of the Constitution, you have to talk about our original constitutional sin. Yes, it's the S word, that word that didn't appear anywhere in the Constitution, and of course I'm speaking of slavery. Madison was the primary author of a document which by its very structure, its very form, its function is democratic in nature, or republican, if you prefer. It was the very concept of self-government, something we refer to as the American experiment, based necessarily then in a certain notion of equality. Now, the franchise didn't include everyone then. It was mostly old white guys like me who were running things, so it was always less than everyone. But, and sorry, ladies, it took a while. We eventually got to you. But one group, of course, that it had no prospect of including was anybody of African descent, certainly anybody who was of African descent and enslaved. And Madison owned slaves. Madison owned over 100 slaves. He owned them. He owned other human beings. Those human beings had nothing in the way of rights. What Madison said went. It was that simple. It was utterly inconsistent with our form of government, utterly inconsistent with everything that Madison stood for, and definitely a moral failing. Because slavery wasn't just a political issue, it is a moral issue. It's always been a moral issue, and Madison never freed his slaves. Never, ever. Now, I know there are some historians here, and you're all thinking, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking presentism. That's a fancy term that historians use. I'm glad lawyers don't make up fancy terms. But historians use this fancy term called presentism, and it's a criticism of people like me, maybe, we'll see in a minute, who apply current moral standards to historical figures. I'm not doing that. I'm applying 18th century standards or early 19th century standards to Madison, because guess what? People knew then that it was immoral too. And they wrestled with this, and some people acquitted themselves better than Madison did. One person was George Washington. Now, he lived his life on the backs of slaves, but at least he emancipated a goodly portion of them, those he was able to that were not, not the property of his wife when he died. Others emancipated them even during their lives. In fact, there were some who emancipated them during their own lives, much to their detriment. In fact, Dolly Madison's father, a fellow by the name of Payne, converted to Quakerism. He became a member of the Society of Friends, and he freed his slaves when Dolly was a girl. Then tried to make it in business and failed, much to his family's economic detriment. But he stood up for his principles. There were examples like that. Madison did not. Now, Madison was opposed to slavery. Madison, from an early age, recognized how repugnant it was. Madison did things along the way in his career that I think legitimately evinced his moral repugnance, his opposition to it. But they were always directed at stopping the spread of slavery. They were always aimed at making slavery somehow slightly less objectionable. They were always aimed at resisting what's commonly called the slave power of the really ardent slave owners, including at places like the Constitutional Convention. I mentioned a moment ago the Constitution doesn't contain the S word, slavery. Some people see that as a failing. It was a compromise. And it was people like Madison who were opposing the more ardent slave owners who wanted to ensconce slavery very expressly and very explicitly in the Constitution. He did not. So, for example, they wanted to perpetuate the slave trade forever. They wanted to say that the slave trade, which was one of the most brutal and controversial parts of slavery, they wanted to say, we can do this forever, and the national government's going to let us do this forever. Madison and others brokered a deal and protected it, not by name, and only for 20 years. Things like the Three-Fifths Clause, which we rightly look back on and say, that's not good. Slaves are not three-fifths of a human being. It's a lot more nuanced and complicated than that. And again, compromise. And Madison was on the right side there. But that very act of compromise really summarizes Madison's attitude. He repeatedly throughout his life was urged to give up his own slaves, urged to do more in the cause of abolition, and his response was always, there's no point. I can sense the political winds. We can't do any more than we're doing. I'm doing the best I can. History will have to judge whether he was doing the best he could, and the counterexample is a fellow you may never have heard of, but he was very close to Madison, and he was actually a first cousin of Dolly. His name was Edward Coles. I'm just curious, how many people have actually heard of Edward Coles? Yeah, a couple. All the old guys. Sorry about that, I was just teasing you. Edward Coles was Madison's private secretary between 1810 and 1815. He's a young man at the time. He was an aristocratic man. He was born, just like Madison was, into a slave-owning family. He, just like Madison, from an early age, was repelled by slavery. But in contrast to Madison, Edward Coles vowed that when he inherited his slaves, and he realized that was going to be a big part of his inheritance, that he was going to find a way to free them. Now, he wasn't able to do it immediately, but eventually, after a period of years, he sold a bunch of property, took his slaves with him to the Northwest Territory, to the territory of Illinois, and on the way there, told them, you're now free. And moreover, come on with me, and I'm going to buy each of you 160 acres, and I'm going to set you up as independent farmers, as free men and women in Illinois. He did that to his great economic detriment. Then, because people were still arguing about slavery in Illinois, he went back and forth politically, ran for governor by a very narrow margin, and fought the battle and made sure that Illinois remained a free state rather than a slave state in the early 19th century. So you have a counterexample. You have an example of a fellow who did act on his convictions and showed by his example and by his later political advocacy that there was an alternate path. Could Madison have done that? Well, he had some other fish to fry, didn't he? I mean, there's that whole independence thing, there's that whole Constitution thing, there's that whole Bill of Rights thing. So maybe we give him some consideration, but nonetheless, we have to say, not Jimmy's finest hour. But I mentioned the Bill of Rights, so let's talk about some good things. The Bill of Rights was something Madison was opposed to. What? He didn't think it was necessary, because he had constructed a constitution of limited enumerated powers, and in fact he divided up the national government into three parts, and between those two actions, the limitations and the setting these in opposition to one another, he said, hey, look, this national government can't invade our rights because it doesn't have the power to invade our rights. And moreover, if we put a Bill of Rights together, we might come up with what's considered to be an exclusive list, and we can't anticipate every right that we might think is going to be fundamental to our freedom. So we don't want to do that, and moreover, these are just parchment barriers. I mean, either people are going to respect our freedoms or they're not going to. And you don't need what the English have a Bill of Rights because they had a king. We don't have any king, we're the king, we, the people. It's right there. See what this thing I did? I think maybe there's a bit of pride of authorship there too. But then, in the ratification debates, that foul scoundrel, that fellow you've heard of, that Patrick Henry, he and other anti-federalists made great hay out of the absence of a Bill of Rights. In fact, George Mason, who'd been at the convention, refused to sign. I believe Edmund Randolph did too, because there was no Bill of Rights primarily. State of North Carolina, the only state to vote down the Constitution, refused to ratify on that basis. Rhode Island, they didn't do anything because they're crazy people up there. They actually called them Rogue Island then, at that point. Did you know that 200 some odd years later, when the governor of Pennsylvania invited all the governors of the original 13 states to commemorate the 200th anniversary of the Constitution in 1987, everybody accepted, except the current governor of Rhode Island, who said, we'll be there in a few years when we ratify. But Madison recognized as a political matter, and ultimately at the urging of his buddy Jefferson, I know we don't mention that name here much, but he was kind of important too, that a Bill of Rights was important. And it was politically necessary. So he said, here's the deal. You ratify, don't put any conditions in your ratification, but then we will make it our first order of business to use Article 5, which is the amendment article of the Constitution, to propose a Bill of Rights and pass it. And when Madison was elected to the first Congress, guess what? He kept his promise. He kept his promise despite the fact that he and the other Federalists had majorities, and the other Federalists said, that was just election talk. Let's get on with more important business. Madison said, no, we promised, I promised, we're going to do this. He took the lead. He wrote the Bill of Rights. He proposed, I think it was 16. Congress, by its two-thirds majority that was necessary for its recommendation, approved 12. Those 12 were sent to the states, and on December the 15th, 1791, 10 of them were ratified. There's our Bill of Rights. Now, Madison had practical reasons as well. He was afraid that if there wasn't a Bill of Rights, you'd never get North Carolina, you'd never get Rhode Island, and moreover, they might use, the people in Congress and the people in the nation might use Article 5 to call another convention and undo all the good that had been done. Yes, he had practical reasons, political reasons, for following through on that promise. But a promise is a promise. He followed through, and because of that, we've got a Bill of Rights. We've got a darn good Bill of Rights. In fact, that's the part of the Constitution that a lot of people consider to be the heart of it. Now, I might differ. I mean, you have to create a government before you have a Bill of Rights, but it's still pretty darn important. And so Jimmy came through on that particular one. So Madison, imperfect. Madison struggled just as we all struggle with ethics. Madison, not so good on slavery. But Madison, very, very good on another, and arguably more fundamental question. The Bill of Rights did come through, did behave ethically, and by golly, I'm thankful for it. I hope that you are too. And that's the end of my prepared remarks, believe it or not. And I'm going to invite President Alger up with me, and we're going to take a few minutes and answer any and all of your questions definitively. We have the definitive answers up here for you right now. So are there any questions at all? And if there are, would you mind coming down in the front so that we could hear you on the microphones?
We have both sides here.
Yeah, absolutely. By the way, while we're getting ready to do this, when we're finished, we've got a really fun thing for you here. We're going to do some quizzes. Okay, question, sir.
Okay.
First, you got to tell us who you are for everyone.
My name's Haas Spencer. Uh-huh. I'm a part-time instructor in journalism here. And I think I see a few of my students. Good job. this is to either of you. The person who spoke before the president said something about violating federal copyright law by recording this event, but that doesn't square with my knowledge of fair use, so maybe we could clarify that.
Wow, we've really gone straight down into the weeds, haven't we? But absolutely.
I'm a journalism instructor, so it's important for me to find this out.
Very, very important. Tremendous. Do you want to take a first bite of that, or would you like me to?
You can start, and I'll be happy to.
Tremendous. The Constitution basically constitutionalizes intellectual property. We have something called the Trademark and Patent Office. Okay, so most of this law is federal. It's extremely constitutional. And the general concept is that if one person creates something, whether it's an invention, you get a patent, or a work of art, which of course clearly we're creating right now, and a recording, okay, then they have a certain right to control that through either a patent or a copyright, and other people don't have a right to use it. And so I think that was the gist of the sort of standard warning that we had here. Now, are there exceptions to that? Of course. There are exceptions for educational entities, for journalists to use things that are newsworthy. But it's a gray area of law. Exactly how much of this could you go out and use? In what context could you use it? Are you adding value to it with other commentary that you might add to it? I suspect you would have a fair use if you used a relatively short segment of this and you talked about how good looking the presenter was. That would be a fair use. But if, on the other hand, you simply wanted to take the entire thing and sell it, because, of course, people will pay big money for this, Okay, and then you'd be taking our right, or JMU's right. Is that a pretty good summary?
That's very good, yes.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
And that is something that is a little different. People forget that the intellectual property is actually, there is a provision in the Constitution that deals with it. And when you say, well, why is it there? People think, well, it's to protect the rights of the creators. But actually, that wasn't the purpose. It actually says that it's to promote the progress of science and the useful arts. So it actually, the idea of protecting intellectual property was to try to give incentives to people to create things that would benefit society. Now, in an instance like this, part of when you talk about fair use is, you know, we have a radio show that we're preparing for, and that obviously
don't
we have a
copy that
presenter.
That's extremely important because
that's part of the reason why you hear obviously those types of things. And when you come to the Forbes Center and there are guest performers, there are contracts obviously that they sign, and there, not to get too much into the weeds, but obviously questions about when you come to a performance, you know, is that different than just something that you, you know, observe in some other fashion? Are you sort of agreeing to a certain set of rules when you come? But it's an important question, and I will say that Professor Harris has been wonderful about making his work available for all sorts of uses here. And so certainly if there are things that you want to do, we can talk. So
you can write as many articles about me as you wish. Feel
Thank
free.
You. Thank you both very much.
Okay, sure, absolutely. That's a good question.
Yeah.
Anybody else have any questions? Anything about Madison or about ethics or slavery? Hey, we have one coming up here. Slavery or the Bill of Rights? Was anyone actually listening when I was talking before? I mean, or was it just crystal clear?
We have a question over here.
Tremendous.
Thank you.
Hi, thanks. I really enjoyed your talk. And I'm an alumnus of JMU.
Uh-huh.
And this is about ethics. And I've been active with climate change.
Oh, and, good, yeah.
And I see that you have some environmental background. And I didn't read the whole book, but I perused Donald Brown's book 2 years ago. I think he teaches law in Pennsylvania. But the title of the book is Climate Change, Ethics, Navigating the Perfect Moral Storm. And he says that ethics has been the crucial missing element in the debate for the last 35 years, and that it's a tremendous tragedy. And I was wondering if you or anybody that you know with ethics are focusing on this. He says that ethicists should take a public stand on particular public policy. And so I just wondered if you'd comment on that.
Thank you for that excellent question, and I will respond by saying I am married to the world's biggest tree hugger. She's sitting right over there in the red. Her name is Priscilla Harris. She teaches environmental law and could no doubt answer much more fully and more capably than I am, but I'm not going to let her because I'm an attention hog. I didn't warn her on this one. I think that it's an excellent modern parallel for a couple of reasons. First of all, there's a huge moral issue there, right? There is no scientific debate any longer. There's always some on the margins. Climate change is happening. We are causing the bulk of it. There's just no question beyond that. This issue has been raised by a scientist who also happens to lead the Roman Catholic Church. His name is Pope Francis, I believe. It's a huge moral issue. And it presents a really interesting dilemma. Because again, though we criticize Madison, let's also put the focus on ourselves. On a per capita basis, check me on this, Mr. President, check me on this, dear. On a per capita basis, this is the number one carbon emitting country, emitter of greenhouse gases. Now, China might edge us out in total because they've got like five times the population or whatever they've got that we've got here. But we emit. So look around you, and we're all environmental sinners in some sense. There's a moral issue here. Now, like Madison, we confront the choice of what do we do on an individual basis. How many of us are willing to give up all of our electronic devices? How many of us are willing to give up our air conditioning? How many of us are willing to give up all the things that make our modern life so comfortable? How many of us are really, really happy because gas prices are low? Well, yeah, I don't like paying any more money than I have to, but maybe we should be doing something to make those prices higher so that we can move to alternative sources of energy. And ask yourself, this is an individual choice, ask yourself, is there a moral component to what you do? And does that impact politics? And I think that there is a question there. And it's maybe in some senses the modern analog in some broad sense to the slavery issue in the 18th century. I mean, Madison lived on the backs of slaves. He could never get off those backs. We live, in a way, on the back of the entire planet, and other people in other places are paying a much greater price than we are. That's a big moral issue. Yeah, I went out on a limb here. I'm getting political on these people, no, Mr. President. It's up to you.
Just one quick thing to add. You, all of you that are here at the university know that, of course, we have a new initiative called the Madison Collaborative, Ethical Reasoning in Action. And part of that is to introduce all of our students to 8 key questions that were developed by our faculty, not to tell them what all the answers are to difficult ethical dilemmas, because sometimes there are difficult questions where there are people who honestly believe based on their sense of morals and ethics and have different opinions, right? That's to be expected in a society like ours. But the purpose of having that kind of initiative here at JMU is to get students thinking beyond themselves in their personal and professional and civic lives, to think about the impact of their choices and their decisions on the people and the world around them. So it's something, I know we've got some of the faculty experts who teach this here today, but it's important for us to start to get students into that mindset, into that habit of thinking about the impact of their decisions, even things that we don't ordinarily think about. The example you gave is great. You know, most people aren't thinking when they go to fill up their car with gas about the impact, when they turn on their air conditioner. But having a program like this helps us to start to think about the impact of our choices on the lives of others and certainly on the planet as well. Mark, did you have a question? I know as you came towards the front, I wanted to...
I did, yes.
Yeah.
Please. These are some good questions. You got some smart people
here. We'll wait till you hear this guy.
Oh, okay.
No pressure.
So very much appreciated your talk. Thank you very much. And I wanted to ask you actually a history question, even though philosophy is what I teach. I've been doing a little bit of reading lately, The Federalist, and some of the history surrounding the formation of the Constitution and its ratification. And so you mentioned that Madison brought forward 16 articles, of which 12 were sent out to the states for ratification, and of which 10 then were ratified. I was wondering if you could speak of the 4 of the 16 that didn't make it out to the states, and of the 2 of the 12 that were not accepted by the states.
Want to take this one?
No.
Okay.
I defer to my expert.
Now, this is where I'm going to do something very ethical here. I'm going to tell you right off the bat that those first 4 that didn't make it to the states, I don't know off the top of my head what they were. I said, that just comes in, I don't know. Now, I've looked at them in the past, and I could probably find them fairly quickly, but that's not what we're going to do here today. So on that one, I fail. Okay. But I can tell you about the 2 that got proposed by 2/3 of Congress but didn't get ratified. The first of them was the Crazy Amendment that had to do with voting representation and used a mathematical formula that, to this day, people still don't understand. I'm serious. Nobody seriously. It's like, it was the First Amendment. It was the first of the 12. That's another interesting anomaly. The ones that actually got ratified were 2 through 12. So what we now call the First Amendment was actually the Second Amendment. The Third Amendment, okay? It was actually the Third Amendment. Be that as it may, so the first one was crazy. The second one, now this is an interesting amendment, didn't get ratified immediately, but what it provided was basically this, and I paraphrase, Congress can raise its own salary, but only prospectively, and there has to be an election between that salary raise and when it takes effect. Okay, it's a check of the people on the Congress, right? Does that sound familiar to you? Yeah, it does sound familiar because that very amendment was ratified as the 27th Amendment in 1992. So it was proposed in 1791. It's ratified. How could that happen? Well, you'll notice Article 5, which is the amendment provision, doesn't have an expiration date. If you have an amendment, you get 2/3 of Congress to propose it, it just goes out there like, okay, now it has to be ratified by 3/4 of the state whenever. And what happened was people forgot about what was originally the Second Amendment and later became the 27th Amendment until some student, it was like 1980, was saying, hey, I think this is still out here. And he noticed that both the first and the second were still out here. He looked at the first, he goes, yeah. He looked at the second, he said, this is a good idea. So he started afresh a campaign for ratification. He figured out which states had ratified back in the 1790s. He said, well, you need like 8 more or 10 more, whatever it is. He started a campaign, and guess what? Like 12 years later, poof. That is such a cool story, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a cool story.
It is.
Yeah, even though I didn't remember those first four, I'm sorry. I'll look them up at some point.
There's probably a historian here who can remember those four. I know. I've read them too, but they are sort of forgotten.
They are, yeah. I'm kind of curious now as to what they were. Maybe there's some other good ideas out there. It could be, you know, actually, yeah. You know, when I started this radio show, I thought to myself, you know, I'm going to run out of ideas. Never. Yeah. There's always something new. Our first episode, in fact, we just did our 200th episode. Is that cool? Yay, me. Okay. The first one was on the constitutionality of secession. That's a cool subject, right? Yeah. That's kind of cool. We had a war over that one, and I think the answer is no. The last episode we just did was called Good, Evil, and a Game of Thrones. And I talked to a political scientist from Roanoke College who thinks that it's possible to be both a good person and an effective politician, and he resents things like the Game of Thrones, where if you're a Stark, you're dead. There's always a new way to look at this. There's always a new way to look at this stuff and a new angle on this, and so good idea, and I think I'm going to look into that.
Yeah, and you know, I think part of what that question though reminds us of, Stuart, is that when we talk about the Constitution and Madison and the other founding fathers, they didn't necessarily get their way on everything.
It doesn't reflect
a document that one person wrote and everybody just agreed to all of the provisions. And so sometimes I think when we revere the founding fathers and the Constitution, we forget that there was a lot of compromise, a lot of back and forth, a lot of disagreement. Madison himself lost a lot of arguments as he was putting this together. So I think it's just important for us to keep in mind when we think about the Constitution. It was actually a pretty messy business in getting put together.
Extremely messy business. Now, I'm looking at the powers that be. Are we about at the point where we need to sit down and do a few quizzes? Unless there's some other really pithy, urgent, wonderful question that we haven't addressed? Okay.
Ready?
Why don't we do that then? Sure.
Pete. Oh. A veteran of Virginia state government coming
down. A veteran of Virginia state government. Well, we're honored since, of course.
My question's about the 10th Amendment.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, boy. No controversy
I'm sure
there.
You wouldn't be surprised.
Okay.
Pete Giesen from a part-time instructor for political science.
Welcome.
Thank you. It just came to light in my emails yesterday that West Haven, Connecticut, is now trying to outdo New London City, City of New London, on taking private property and then selling it to another private entity.
Uh-oh.
This is for economic development. Supreme Court, Kylo versus the City of New London. What's your opinion as to Jefferson's ethics as to that type of approach to the 10th Amendment, to the rights of states?
My. Again, you want to take this one?
No,
you don't want to.
We have special guests. Thank you, Pete, for another simple question.
Very, very interesting. Very, very interesting.
I haven't sat down yet.
Feel free. You can sit right there and pop back up. The 10th Amendment is a fascinating amendment. And it's, generally speaking, I think I can paraphrase it fairly closely, all those powers that are not granted to the central government or denied by the Constitution to the states are reserved to the states or to the people. There's a lot of controversy over the actual interpretation of the 10th Amendment. The court has actually said it's a mere truism that says all that's not been delegated to the federal government remains with the states, which is inherent in the actual structure of the Constitution. And the court said that, but the court has subsequently said, no, the 10th Amendment does have something to it. It preserves something called a zone of sovereignty. And so there are some things that are beyond federal power. Okay, so it has some meaning here. But with respect, I think the more relevant provision of the Constitution in the Kelo case and for what you're concerned about is the Fifth Amendment, and specifically the Takings Clause. Okay, the Takings Clause of the Fifth Amendment takes a little explanation. It deals with a pre-existing concept called eminent domain. Back in England, the king owned everything. He had the highest property right of anything. He gave things to his nobles, but he could always take them back, and occasionally he would. Hey, I really like your castle. That's mine! Okay, the king can do that. Okay? our Fifth Amendment places a limit on that power. It says, yeah, the government can take things for public use. That's a limitation. You can't just take it back because you like my castle for a public use, but then you have to pay just compensation. So two provisions, limitation to only public uses and just compensation. Most cases where the government takes something from you, hey, I like your house because I want to put a road through there, well, you just argue over how much they have to pay you for your house. But in New London, Connecticut, about 10 years ago, almost exactly 10 years ago, a woman named Kilo said, wait a second, taking my house, my little pink house, my restored Victorian house, and saying that I live in a blighted neighborhood, and saying you're going to do an economic redevelopment project, and you're going to give this, I think it was to Pfizer, okay, and you're going to give this to another private property owner, no way, that is not a public use. Pretty compelling argument. I mean, I don't like the idea of somebody condemning my house and giving it to Donald Trump to build a casino, okay, or to any other private party. I don't like that idea. Supreme Court said that's okay. Yeah, I know, 5-4, I see your hands. Yes, 5-4, but guess what? Guess what the Constitution means? Constitution means whatever five members of that court say it means, ever since 1803, Marbury versus Madison, okay? So we have to deal with it. That's an extremely controversial decision. And I'll simply say that the court was at pains to say, we're not saying this is a good idea. We're not judging whether New London, Connecticut, or the state of Connecticut is doing the right thing. We're simply saying we think this falls within the broad category of public use. Because if they said otherwise, then basically economic redevelopment projects would stop. That's still not going to make Ms. Kilo happy. And a lot of states have adopted limits on their own use pursuant to their own constitutions or their own statutes. And I believe the state of Virginia, the Commonwealth, excuse me, is one of those. So basically the Supreme Court has said, you guys can go ahead and do this if you want to, no problem with the Fifth Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. And Virginia and other states have said, no, thank you, we're not going to do that. That's how that's been resolved.
Yeah. Great. Wait, are you ready?
Let's do some quizzes, shall we?
All right.
Let's get some people up here. Okay, all right. Tremendous. Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Yeah, take them.
Okay, now this is the audience participation section. And if we don't have any contestants, we're just going to be really boring. Okay? So we need some people to come down front, and as an incentive, every contestant gets a pocket constitution from James Madison's Montpelier, and they're going to be prepared for you and ready right afterward by the beautiful Danielle. Stand up. There's the beautiful Danielle. Wave at the camera. Everyone. Yeah, yeah, thank you, Danielle. Okay. She's got a constitution for everybody, and she's got T-shirts with that cool logo on it. No, not that guy, the blue one from the radio show. So if you come down and you take the quiz and you win, you get a T-shirt. Now, come on. All right, we have a brave one. Tremendous.
All right. People want to start lining up.
You have to go to the microphone, please.
Yes.
To the microphone. We all have to hear you. Oh, tremendous. We got a few contestants here.
Oh, very good.
Okay, who's going to be first?
I'll be first.
Tremendous. Speak into the microphone, please. Who are you, sir?
I'm Rex Fuller. I'm a retired professor, which means I'm very much out of date, and that's why I come.
That's perfect. We're happy to have you, Professor Fuller. We're very happy to have you indeed. So you taught here at JMU?
I did.
What did you teach?
Students.
But okay, good. Excellent. And what kind of stuff
Speech communication, rhetoric and public address.
How did I guess that? I think this guy's comfortable in a microphone.
He is.
Okay. Do you mind if I call you Rex?
Absolutely.
Okay, you do mind?
I don't mind.
Okay. Rex, have at it. Oh, well, no. We're not. It's up to you.
Yes.
Because normally I started the show with the quiz lady. She left Montpelier to have a baby. Yay. Okay. So now we go with Doug Smith, the head of the center for the Constitution. He's the quiz guy. He's not here today. They're doing their own thing at Montpelier. So today we have the quiz prez. And the quiz prez. With the help of some of his excellent staff, notably Bill Wilson,
thank you very much, Bill,
has come up with some really tough questions. So Rex, quiz prez, have at it.
Okay, Rex, you ready for this? Now listen very carefully. This is, I'm sure, the hardest question of this group. And multiple choice, okay? Who is considered the father of the Constitution? Now here are your choices. A, Benjamin Franklin. B, George Washington, C, James Monroe, or D, James Madison.
Okay, we're not giving him a t-shirt for that.
Bill wrote the questions.
What is up with this, Bill? Come on.
I realized in my introduction I actually gave away the answer, too. But that's
those t-shirts cost money, Bill.
Yes. Maybe we should ask him which two of these individuals ran against each other for a congressional seat. That might be a...
Well, let's let him answer this one, right, and then I have a follow-up question. But go on, please.
What was the question? I think the answer is probably the namesake of this great university.
James Madison. Correct, sir. Correct. Yay. Well said. Correct. Now, wait a second. You want a t-shirt? Here's your follow-up question. What is the name of James Madison's stepson's horse? Oh, I didn't think you knew that. Too bad for you. Go on up there, and the lovely Danielle will give you your prize. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you for being here.
Thank you very much.
All right.
All right, who's next?
I'm Tracy Zimmerman. I'm in the School of Writing, Rhetoric, and Technical Communication.
Well, welcome, Tracy. We're so happy to have you.
Here.
You're in the school, so you teach there.
I do.
What specific courses do you teach?
I have taught a course called Language, Law, and Ethics, and I do some things with sort of digital questions and ethics and things like that.
So this is like right up your alley.
Sort of, yes.
Right. So did we get it right?
I'm going to try.
No, did we get it
right? But I'm not perfect. I don't want to be revered.
Okay, you don't want to be revered? Okay, all right, okay. Well, I understand. Well, we will respect you.
Thank you.
Tremendous. Quiz Prez, do you have one?
I do, and I hate to tell you, but it will be a little more difficult than Rex's
Rats.
Questions.
So. I knew I should have gone first.
All right, so here's your question.
Okay.
Much like today, in the 1780s, many Americans distrusted a strong central government. This distrust is shown by the... A, lack of debate over the ratification of the United States Constitution. B, the plan of government set up by the Articles of Confederation. C, the development of a federal court system. Or D, the constitutional provision for a strong president.
Oh, rats.
I got to hear that one again.
Do you want to hear that one again?
All
right.
Could you give me the origin?
The question.
Country of origin?
Okay, yes. All right. Thanks, Bill. Here's the question again. Everybody listen carefully. Much like today, in the 1780s, many Americans distrusted a strong central government. That should be a familiar theme, certainly, if you watched the debate last night.
So right? The 1780s, so like mostly before the Constitution, okay.
Right.
Okay.
So this distrust is shown by which of these things? The lack of debate over the ratification of the Constitution.
Let's take them one by one. Is that a good answer?
I'm going to say no on that.
They talked a little about that,
yeah,
didn't they?
Yeah, they did. I'm pretty sure.
Okay, so we can eliminate A.
I'm going to eliminate A.
All okay. Right. B is the plan of government set up by the Articles of Confederation.
Now, see, that one's tempting, and I'm leaning towards B, but I'd like to hear C and D one more time.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so C is the development of a federal court system.
What do you think about that one?
See, my answer, if I were just answering this as a short answer, I'd say it would be the separation of powers in Article 1, 2, 3, and having that kind of setup would show that kind of distrust, but that's post what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to say no for C.
No okay. For C, okay.
And then D is the constitutional provision for a strong president.
I'm going to go with B.
B, okay. Before we go with that, what was B again?
The plan of government set up by the Articles of Confederation.
So why do you think that evinces some sort of distrust of government?
I couldn't tell you. It's just a feeling I have.
Well, Quiz Prez.
And the answer is B.
B, well done. Right.
Excellent.
Well done. Now, before we go on, though, let's elaborate just a little bit. Now, some of you may not be familiar with the Articles of Confederation. That was our form of government from 1781 to 1787. And the reason that answer is completely correct is because it had almost no central government. All we had was the former Continental Congress, now renamed the Confederation Congress. There was no real executive. There was no independent federal judiciary. The federal government, the national government, I should say, had no power to tax people directly. And although it had nominal authority over things like foreign affairs, it's kind of hard to conduct foreign affairs with no executive, no army, no navy, no nothing. Okay, it was sort of the ultimate in states, it was called states' rights, because the states were essentially the only seats of sovereign power, and the articles were essentially just a treaty between those 13 sovereign states. Didn't work so well. Didn't work so well. And so, yes, that's the reason the answer is incorrect. And so, well done, B.
Yes, and you certainly see signs of this even today, right? That you probably, many of you have seen the flag that says, "Don't tread on me," right? This idea of a distrust of a strong central government. Of course, you're coming right out of the American Revolution, King George III, and so there were a lot of concerns with any really strong central power. And of course, a certain level of skepticism about government and its power is probably a very good thing, but too much of it can lead right to a situation that's unworkable, which is, I think, where our country found itself under the Articles of Confederation.
Well said, sir. Well said.
Ready for number three?
You should, you know, like be a university president or something. You know this stuff. All right, who do we got next?
I'm Ned Sieverts, and I'm a student here.
Ned, where are you from, Ned?
I'm from Arlington, Virginia, so just
Arlington,
outside the D.C.
Right?
area.
Just down the road, so you can go home on the weekends and do laundry.
No, I'm a good student.
Tremendous. Okay, well, Ned, what are you majoring in?
Political science.
Okay, well, that sounds like right up your alley then. Yeah. Quiz prez, do we have a question for Ned?
We do. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. The original purpose of the Philadelphia Convention was to A, recommend amendments to the Articles of Confederation, B, write a new constitution, C, abolish the Articles of Confederation, or D, choose the first president.
Hey, come on now. Who's blurting out answers back there? This is just like Wheel of Fortune, okay?
That's right.
Shh! Stop it. Don't solve the puzzles. I'm not saying that was the right answer. I'm saying that Rex has a very big mouth back there. Okay.
Well, since Professor Pete is my professor that I just came from class from, I'm going to go with A.
You're going to go with A. What was A again?
Recommend amendments to the Articles of Confederation.
And that was the one I was considering, but Pete secured my answer.
Oh,
this
right.
is the phone a friend concept.
Yeah. Is that the phone a friend concept? Yeah. Well, did he get it right?
And the correct answer is A, recommend amendments to the Articles of Confederation.
Now, there's a little bit more to that one as well. Now, the Articles of Confederation required, get this now, I think it was Article 6 of the Articles of Confederation required that for any significant action, there had to be unanimous consent of the states, right? Now, again, the pizza analogy, if you had 13 friends over, they're going to be unanimous in anything. No, that was one of the real weaknesses of the articles. So people realized that even though that was the original way they sold this convention, that we need to fix the articles, especially with regard to the regulation of commerce, which was a huge issue in the 1780s, they sold it that way, but as soon as they got there, Madison basically pulled out the Virginia plan, and implicit in that was, guys, we just got to throw it all out and start from scratch. And this was practically seditious. Yeah. I mean, these guys were ultra-virus. That's a fancy legal term for it. They were going way beyond what many of their state assemblies had authorized. And in fact, I think it was Patterson, when he showed up from New Jersey, he was like, what are you people doing? And he proposed a complete alternate plan that basically went back to the articles. And it was only because the convention adopted a rule of secrecy, and it was only because they observed it, that people like Patrick Henry were sort of blindsided. If he'd known what was going on there and shown up, he would have thrown a wrench into this whole thing. So that was a huge issue, huge issue.
Yeah, we might just mention too, it's hard to conceive of it today, but there was still an awful lot of loyalty to the individual states, much more than a sense of being united as a country, right? And a lot of it had to do with the distances, the difficulties of travel and communication at the time. So there was much more isolation of these individual states from one another. And frankly, they didn't necessarily trust one another in terms of having each other's best interests. So It was a really complicated time, and all the more remarkable when we see what came out of it.
When you think of the 1780s and the level of cooperation between the various states, think of football rivalries. Right? How much do state football teams at various state institutions like each other? They don't even like each other within the same state.
So that was kind of how the 1780s
were, and that's why we basically needed to throw out that system and start afresh. Kudos to James Madison. He recognized that. All righty. Thank you, Quiz Prez, and thank you. And on we go to the next contestant. Who do we have now?
Hi, I'm Will, and I'm a history major.
Will, history. A history major from where, Will?
From Arlington as well.
From Arlington. So everybody's from Arlington today.
Ned and I went to high school together.
Did you really? Well, isn't that sweet? Are you BFFs?
Yes, we
absolutely.
Are.
Tremendous. Well, I'm very happy to hear that. Quiz Prez, do we have a hard one this time?
Sure. Well, this is, you know, they're getting a little bit harder, I think. We'll see.
Not too hard.
Of course, your history, right? You've got, all right. As we celebrate Constitution Day, it's, of course, important to remember that our Constitution replaced the original Articles of Confederation, as we just discussed. One way in which the Constitution differed from the Articles of Confederation was that the Constitution, A, provided for the direct election of the president by the voters, B, made the amendment process more difficult, C, created a national government having three branches, or D, increased the powers of the states.
I want to go with C.
What was C again?
Created a national government having three branches.
Well, I don't know. I think that's kind of a silly answer. You sure you want to go with that one?
I'm pretty confident.
You're pretty confident of that one? Nobody wants to talk him out of it? No, I don't think we're going to be able to budge him on this one. Is he correct, Quiz Prez?
He is correct.
Well
C,
done.
Created
C,
a national government. I would say, at least my own observation, though, while that is certainly true, and we all, of course, learned about the three branches of government, right, in civics, hopefully in high school and younger, at the time, it seems to me at least that the legislative branch had, in some ways, the most defined role, and that the others took some time to really be fleshed out.
No, I agree with you. In fact, back in 2007, I had the honor of addressing some members of the Virginia General Assembly on the occasion of the 400th anniversary of the landing at Jamestown. And in order to do that, I went back and looked at some of the original Jamestown charters. That too, those charters set up one branch of government, and it was effectively the Virginia General Assembly. You know, of course, it became the House of Burgesses, and it's, you know, all the way down. But that was the only form of government we had for a long time, and so that's what we were used to. And so, yeah, I think that's why it's in Article I now. Everyone knew what a legislature looked like and what it did. But then we had to really figure out later what we're going to do with this president guy.
Right.
And these judges over here, that took even longer. That took like 10 years before we figured that out. Cool. Well, who are you?
My name is Andrew Havilison. I am a senior. I'm from Virginia Beach, Virginia.
I didn't understand a word of what you just said. What is your name?
My name's Andrew.
Andrew. Now we got that. Now, what was the rest of that?
I'm a senior, and I am from Virginia Beach, Virginia.
Virginia okay, Beach. Virginia Beach, Virginia. Tremendous. Andrew, thank you very much. What are you majoring in?
I am majoring in communication studies and political science.
Pretty good thing. That's a good double major. Good very impressed. Okay. Well, Quiz Prez, what do we have for Andrew?
Okay, well, building on what we just talked about, we're now going to turn to the courts. A lasting impact of the U.S. Supreme Court under Chief Justice John Marshall is that the Supreme Court's decisions, A, extend the Bill of Rights to enslaved persons, B, expanded the power of the federal government, C, restricted the authority of Congress, or D, promoted the views of the president?
Well, John Marshall, he was very well known for, I'm gonna have to go with B, expanding the rights of the federal government, the powers.
You don't like the other answers?
No, I don't.
And you don't want to tell me why?
I could tell you why. Could you read them again?
Sure, you want me to read the choice again? Yeah. All right, so of course, this is under Chief Justice John Marshall. Which of these is true of the Supreme Court's decisions? Did they extend the Bill of Rights to enslaved persons?
That did they was do that?
No, they did not. That did not come about to the 13th Amendment.
Okay.
B has expanded the power of the federal government.
Yes, he did.
Okay, that's your answer, okay.
C is restricted the authority of Congress.
No, they didn't.
And D is promoted the views of the president.
No.
No, you're sure? No,
I'm sure.
I can't get you off B.
Nope, that's my final answer.
Well?
Quiz prize, you gotta give the answer now.
The answer, according to our official writer here, Bill, is C, restricted the authority of...
Oh, no, typo.
That's a typo, I'm sorry.
Yes, that's all right.
So...
We corrected that.
I'm sorry, I didn't get that, Bill.
That's all right.
So the correct
Bill,
answer is...
it's on you! Andrew is correct. It was B. Okay. Tremendous.
But is there that with Marbury versus Madison in Judicial Review? You don't think there's an article for...
We could debate it. No,
I actually, the reason that I didn't notice that is I was thinking about the Judicial Review that came about under the Chief Justice,
you know, you
which
actually
does
could
restrict
make
the authority of Congress.
The problem with you, John, is that you know too much. And, you know, quite frankly, that is actually a very good answer in its own right for exactly the reason you say. So let's discuss it a little bit more. As the quiz prez was saying, Marbury versus Madison in 1803 created the power of judicial review, and that was probably the single most important decision in all of constitutional history, and certainly of John Marshall. And yes, in declaring itself the arbiter and saying that it could reverse Congress and declare something unconstitutional, no, you're very good. You're exactly right. Okay, Bill. Maybe C was a good answer. Now I see where you were going with it. I insisted, however, just before we got here, that we needed to go with a more general answer, B, because the general thrust of what Marshall did once he took that power of judicial review was to expand federal power.
That's certainly true.
So in other words, it's just a very, very badly drafted question, and that's entirely Bill's fault. Thank you. No, actually, that was very good because we're both good. Yeah. Very good. Tremendous. And that shows you some of the interesting aspects of constitutional law, is that sometimes these things are a little bit debatable.
Yes.
So well done, Andrew. Well done. You got your T-shirt. Okay.
All right.
Hi, I'm Ryan Wendels. I am a senior political science major from New Jersey.
Do you take students from New Jersey?
You better believe it.
We have a few of them here today, I suspect.
Is that a good idea?
I came from New Jersey, too, just saying.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess that's all right. Okay. I've been to New Jersey a few times. All right. Tremendous. Are you ready for a tough question?
Sure.
All right.
All right, Ryan. You ready? Okay. Listen carefully. In framing a government which is to be administered by men over men, the great difficulty lies in this. You must first enable the government to control the governed, and in the next place, oblige it to control itself. This is a quote from Federalist Paper number 51. You've probably read this in a class. This passage refers to which of the following? The need for A, a strong executive, B, a system of checks and balances, C, an independent military, or D, a national education system.
I'm going to go with B, a strong system of checks and balances.
You're sure? And you're going straight to that answer. You don't even want to consider any of the other answers?
Well, we read it last week in class, so pretty sure.
All right. What's the answer, quiz prez?
The answer is indeed B, a system of checks and balances.
And this really, that was Madison, wasn't it? Federalist 51?
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure of that. That really is the essential problem, or one of the essential problems of self-government, and it was something that was very much front and center. I mean, remember, we're back in the 1780s, and the articles are showing that a weak government is worthless. So we got to have something stronger. But even Madison, who at that stage in his career was very much a nationalist and who was a big proponent of a strong national government, recognized fully that you could create what had been called previously the Leviathan, something that is so strong and so overwhelming that it becomes a tyrannical government. And he didn't want to do that. So first, strong government, but then secondly, do something. something to keep it from becoming tyrannical. And that's where Madison borrowed an idea of separation from powers from Montesquieu.
Yeah, and one of the things I think it's interesting about that notion of checks and balances, we talked earlier, you talked about Madison being imperfect, right? That, that he was a human being who had faults. And he recognized this about human nature. An awful lot of what he wrote about was how do you create a government when men are not angels, right? And so this idea that people are fallible and we need a system that will control for that somehow was, I think, a central theory of his that was it was critical to the system of government they were creating to deal with the fact that people are indeed imperfect. So it's just kind of an interesting recognition that he had about human nature.
That is such a cool point, and I'm going to expand a little bit on it if you don't mind. This is one of the coolest aspects of our Constitution. It arose from the Enlightenment. And the Enlightenment, if you can sum it up in a single word, it's reason. Okay, if we're going to do something, let's do it in a logical fashion. Madison was the ultimate realist here. He said, I'm a person, I know I'm imperfect, I've studied all these republics and these democracies all throughout history, and I see how imperfect people are. And he was able to diagnose, with the aid of philosophers like John Locke and like Montesquieu and all the others that he read, this is what I think the problem is. So let's create the strong national government, but let's set it against itself, and let's hope then that no one branch will become tyrannical. You can even make a generalized argument. Now I'm going to stray here a little bit outside my area of expertise, but that seems to me is the strength of a capitalistic market system. Okay, it recognizes the essential selfishness of people when they're acting as economic actors. And that's why it, for the most part, works, but that's why it's also an imperfect system requiring some sort of checks on it, some sort of regulation. And that's why other systems, for example, a communist system, that sounds a lot like the Sermon on the Mount, that sounds a lot better than capitalism, since it doesn't take into account what realistically human beings are like. That's why those systems don't tend to work, and they devolve into tyranny. So the Constitution, Madison's Constitution, is an enlightened document based upon reason. That's why it works. And that's a great reason to respect James Madison. He was a realist. And now we have a Republican. I met this guy at lunch. What's your name, sir?
My name is Josh Humphreys, and I'm a senior political science major.
And a Republican.
And a proud Republican.
A proud Republican. Wow. Okay, thanks, Josh. And Josh, I'm going to give you some props because Josh was one of the prime movers, if not the prime mover, behind this brand new election district that's going to be centered here at JMU. So I think... So we all owe you thanks for all your efforts there. And that's also part and parcel and a great example of this entire vision of a civically engaged university. So well done, young man, well done. All right.
Can I move to a difficult one since
Josh
is here?
Yes, let's really hammer. He's a Republican, let's hammer him.
There we go.
Come on.
All right, let's see here. Josh, let's go with Patrick Henry, probably one of your heroes, right? So this is now, keep in mind, of course, Patrick Henry had his run-ins, right, with James Madison and was a great orator, which James Madison, by the way, was not. When we're looking for great Madison quotes, sometimes it's actually hard to find really short, pithy quotes, right? We have a few. But Patrick Henry was quite the orator in his day. So this is Patrick Henry. Give me leave to demand. What right had they, referring to the drafters of the Constitution, to say, we the people. My political curiosity, exclusive of my anxious solicitude for the public welfare, leads me to ask who authorized them to speak the language of we the people instead of we the states. States are the characteristics and the soul of a confederation. If the states be not the agents of this compact, it must be one great consolidated national government of the people of all the states. So this quote by Patrick Henry expresses the anti-federalist, A, fear of a strong national government, B, acceptance of separated and shared powers, C, fear of tyranny of the majority, Or D, acceptance of the necessary and proper clause?
I'm leaning towards answer B.
Okay, what was B again?
B was acceptance of separated and shared powers.
You think Patrick Henry accepted shared powers?
Let's hear them just one more time. That was quite, that was a, sure. That was a lengthy
quote. I'm
not
trying quote. To talk you out of it. Just,
okay. I had to pick a hard one for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I appreciate that.
So A was fear of a strong national government. B was acceptance of separated and shared powers. C was fear of tyranny of the majority. And D was acceptance of the necessary and proper clause.
Well, I think I may change my answer. I may go to answer A, if he seemed like he was a person that was, you know, really in favor of the states having the most authority.
What was answer A again?
Fear of a strong national government.
Right. So he would want the states to have more of the power then.
So you're saying Patrick Henry was a scaredy cat? Is that what you're saying?
Your words, not mine.
But that's what you're saying?
Yeah, kind of.
Okay,
yeah,
all right,
yeah.
That's right. So you like answer A better now?
I would probably go with answer A.
Quiz prez?
And the correct answer is A, fear of
well
a strong
done.
National
government.
That's why they're called the anti-federalists, right?
Indeed. No, that was a lengthy quote, and sometimes when you have those lengthy quotes, you have to pause and think about exactly what they mean.
Exactly.
That was part and parcel. That was basically Patrick Henry's clarion call. That was his his basic position was he didn't like the states. In fact, a quote often, I think, misattributed to him is that when he first started hearing about what happened at the Constitutional Convention, supposedly he said he smelt a rat.
Yes.
I don't know that we've actually got evidence that he said that, but that crystallizes this, and that's why it was so important that he didn't show up too early.
Right.
Okay.
Very good.
Who's this guy?
My name's Matt Mueller. I'm a junior international affairs and political science double major, and I'm from Manassas, Virginia.
Okay.
From Manassas, Virginia. That's a fine place.
Yeah.
They had a battle there.
Yeah, we had two battles there.
Two? Right. You're well. Okay, Mr. Smarty Pants. Okay. Quiz press, give him a hard one. He's a smart guy.
Okay, so a little bit of history here. This should be easy for you, given what you've already demonstrated. So we've been talking about the Philadelphia Convention, right? Which of the following individuals was not at the Philadelphia Convention? A, George Washington. B, James Madison. C, Thomas Jefferson. Or D, Alexander Hamilton.
I'm going to assume that James Madison was, being
okay,
that he wrote
that's
part
a
of it.
Gimme.
Well, give me that one.
I'm going to have to, I think I'm going to lean towards A, George Washington.
George Washington was not at the Constitutional Convention.
I don't think he was. I think at the time, at the end of the Revolution, he wanted to get out of politics, but they called him back to be the first president.
Okay, what are the other choices, just to make sure we go?
The other choices, we'll take Madison out of the mix. I think we've pretty much established he was pretty busy there, right? A was George Washington, C was Thomas Jefferson, and D was Alexander Hamilton.
Okay, so those three, you're thinking George was hanging out at home.
Yeah. I think Thomas Jefferson, because he was one of the lead anti-federalists, was there. I think that Alexander Hamilton was there because he was one of the lead federalists.
Final answer?
I have to go with A.
Quiz prez?
And the correct answer is C.
Oh.
Thomas Jefferson.
Sorry, Matt.
It's fine.
There
we go.
We're sorry, but you know, this is a very important question in a couple of respects. First of all, Bill Wilson and President Alger wanted to have at least one question in here where we could diss Thomas Jefferson. And so we're very happy to do that. Absolutely, yes, absolutely, okay. No, seriously, Thomas Jefferson was busy over in France at the time, and though he and Madison corresponded, they're very, very close friends, they really were BFFs, they corresponded, And definitely Jefferson demonstrated some sort of delayed influence, especially during ratification, especially with regard to the Bill of Rights. He was not in the mix. And when letters are taking a month or 6 weeks to get across the ocean, that's very, very important. And that's, seriously, one of the reasons that I think Madison is unjustly overlooked is when I compare him to somebody like Jefferson. And Jefferson's a great guy. He did great things. You know, he had his issues too, but he did great. You know, Declaration of Independence, all men are created equal, fabulous, great writer, looked great in knee breeches. But he did not participate in the more important document, which was the Constitution. The other important thing to say is that George Washington not only was there, if he'd not been there, probably the whole thing would have failed.
Right.
Because he was the rock star of 18th century America. He was the reason people came. And Madison persuaded him to come.
Absolutely.
Very important subplot in the whole constitutional scheme.
And just a reminder of why Madison ought to get more credit.
Much
right,
more
in
credit.
In Virginia and in the United States.
Much more. We're working on that.
We are.
And we named a university after him.
We did?
We did. Okay. Got it. All right. Who are you?
My name's Lewis.
Lewis. And where are you from, Lewis?
I'm from Fairfax, Virginia.
Really? Okay. And I'm guessing you're a student here.
Yes, that's correct.
And you're a very tall student, so you're having to bend over every time. I'm sorry about that.
No, it's no problem. I'm used to it.
Okay. Tremendous. Well, you're young. You can bend like that. And what are you majoring in, Lewis?
I'm majoring in political science.
Okay. Political science. I detect a pattern here. Don't we have any gym majors or anything like that? Okay. I guess we won't do that. Okay.
All right.
What do you got for Lewis, quiz prez?
Okay. So this is a question about what's not in the Constitution. Which of the following is not mentioned in the Constitution? A, trial by jury. B, public education. C, protections for life, liberty, or property. And D, how the president should be chosen. So which is not mentioned in the Constitution?
I really want to go with B, public education.
B is public education.
Okay, clearly the problem here is that your professors are teaching your students too much. And they're making it too difficult for us to stump them. Mm-hmm. Because I'm going to guess, quiz prez, what's the correct answer?
The correct answer is, in fact, B, public education.
Well done.
Thank you, Gav.
Now, I don't know what you think, Stuart, but I have to say this is one of the questions that for me, when I think about what I think ought to be in the Bill of Rights and what other nations have, there is in other constitutions a recognition that education is vital to a democracy. And our Supreme Court has stopped short of saying that public education is a fundamental right, and to me, when you think about voting and participating as a citizen, especially now in the 21st century, that education is vital. So I would look back on this and say, you know, at the time, education perhaps didn't play quite the same role that it does today, but if I were there, I would certainly have tried to argue for this, and certainly today, if we were writing the Constitution, I think there'd be a strong argument that education underlies the ability to exercise a lot of other rights.
Today, Bill took me on a campus tour. And by the way, what a gorgeous campus. The Bluestone, it's just a gorgeous place. And I was in a tunnel, and I saw something on that tunnel wall. I believe it was a quote, "Knowledge shall forever govern ignorance." That's straight from James Madison, and it just buttresses exactly what the quiz prez just told us. You can't have a functioning democratic republic without knowledge and education. Right. You can't do it. In fact, Jefferson had a really good quote on that, too, that I don't recall the details of. It's absolutely true. Now, here's the interesting thing. You don't even have to look at other nations to find constitutions that guarantee education. In fact, there's a huge case right now pending in Kansas, I think it is, because the Kansas Constitution guarantees a certain right to public education, and I believe that the Kansas Supreme Court declared the state in violation of that provision, and therefore there has this big debate now, what has to be done? Do they have to raise taxes in order to do this or not? And I think maybe that's the reason our Supreme Court has never found it to be a fundamental right, because it has immediate and direct taxing implications. If someone goes in and says, you know, you're not giving me a public education, does that mean the Supreme Court's gonna be setting tax rates? Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that's a good thing or a bad thing. I'm saying I think that's their hesitation. Right. I think that's their hesitation. Fascinating. We have a young lady.
Hi.
I'm so pleased. It's always the guys who get up here.
I figured I would change it up a little bit.
Good for you. Well done. What is your name?
My name's Haley Aldridge. I'm a senior poli-sci major, and I'm from Boston, Massachusetts.
Boston. You're attracting them all the way from Boston.
We are.
Tremendous. Well, Haley, we're very happy to have you with us. And quiz press, what do we have for Haley?
Okay, now let me check the before. Should this be the last one? Okay.
Okay.
All right. Well, this is one of my favorites. So we'll see what you have to say here. So, what did the Senate initially want to call the president? A, King. B, the President of the United States of America. C, His Highness, the President of the United States of America and Protector of their Liberties. Or D, Chief of State and Commander-in-Chief of the United States of America. Oof. Which of these did the Senate initially want to call the President?
Well, I'm going to definitely say it's not King. Probably some bitter feelings there. What was the last two? Because the B is President of the United States.
Correct. And then C is His Highness, the President of the United States of America and Protector of their Liberties. And D is Chief of State and Commander-in-Chief of the United States of America.
I'm going to say it's not C.
Why don't you like C?
Because Highness, that kind of goes along with like King. And I feel like maybe they're trying to get away from that. So between B and C, I mean B and D, sorry. I'm thinking this is like pretty obvious. I don't want to overthink it, so I'm going to go with B.
The one he ended up being called, the President of the United States of America. Called. You sure about that?
No.
This is a hard question, so we're going to introduce, as our last question, we're going to introduce... You can poll the audience.
Okay.
Okay, we want a little more participation here. Who thinks that, what are they again? Let's raise your hand when the quiz prez reads the answer choices.
Give you the choices here, okay? So what did the Senate initially want to call the president? A, King. Any votes for King?
Not seeing any hands. No monarchists
no
here,
hands.
Okay.
All right. B, the President of the United States of America.
Nobody wants your answer choice.
Over here.
Good thing we're
calling
the audience.
Okay. Solidarity. Okay. Two of you. Okay.
All right. C, His Highness, the President of the United States of America and Protector of their Liberties.
Whoa, I'm seeing a bunch of hands going up here. Seeing a bunch of hands going up here.
Okay.
Noted.
And
you ready for D?
D.
And D is Chief of State and Commander-in-Chief of the United States of America.
Oh, a lot of hands on that one too. So you have to look out at the audience and decide which of those two groups of hands contains more people that you think are going to be right.
Yeah. I'm going to go with C.
Okay, so the people who chose D are not as smart, is that?
Can we put those hands up again? We'll see. Yes.
So you're going with C now?
Going with C.
Polling the audience. Quiz prez?
The correct answer is... C.
All right. Now, you might think I was helping Haley out too much there, but the reason I did that is because this one stumped me completely. And in fact, this is another one I questioned of Bill's, and he went back and did the research and showed me that this is exactly what it was. And Haley, you're from Boston, so you'll appreciate this part. Our first vice president, of course, was John Adams, and one of the vice president's duties, not often exercised these days, but one of them, is to preside over the Senate. And Adams participated, to the consternation of the senators, very actively in this debate and made all sorts of suggestions they didn't like. And so someone in the Senate derisively suggested, do you know this one? It's a hilarious story. Derisively suggested that they refer to the vice president as His Rotundity.
Yes, I have heard. Yes.
Yeah, that's a true story.
Yeah.
Cool. I think that has to be our last quiz, and so thanks to everyone for participating. We very much appreciate it.
Anything else you want to say?
No.
Okay. Well, Professor Harris, thank you so much on behalf of all of us at James Madison University. Thanks for making the Constitution fun and relevant. We really appreciate it. How about a hand for Professor
Harris? Thank you.
Now, since you've been so good about giving out prizes, we have a couple of our own from James Madison University. We won't even make you answer a question to get them.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.